Welcome to the Mean Lady Talking Podcast, the tough-talking, advice-giving show by the not-really-mean, mean lady, Susan J. Elliott.
Good day, everybody. This is Susan Elliott, host of Mean Lady Talking Podcast, and welcome to Episode 90. I wanted to thank my meanies. I sent them a little pre-holiday thing about how I'm hoping the new year is going to go. And I'll discuss that more on a future podcast. But I just want to let you guys know I'm just going to pump public podcast out. And I'm going to pump out some meanie-only pod. Even if I haven't pumped out all of these podcasts that I'm recording now, I'm still going to start season 3 in February. And I'll explain a little bit more of that as we get closer to it. But on the last podcast, I said that I was going to discuss boundary setting when you have a fear of conflict. So let's look at the boundary setting thing in an arc. So there's three components. There's beginning, there's the middle, there's the end. The first part of it, fear of conflict, can go in the beginning. And one of the things that you should be thinking about is a three-time rule. I talk about the three-time rule in the books. I talk about the three-time rule in the workbook. When you've asked somebody for something twice and they haven't given it to you, done it for you, whatever it is, on the third ask, you're bargaining with yourself. So on the third time where you're going to need to ask somebody something, you need to figure out, am I going to bargain with myself or am I going to set a boundary? So that's the question. The other part of that inquiry is, I know I'm sounding like a lawyer right now, but the other part of that inquiry is about the boundary itself. What am I trying to achieve here? And I'm going to use a concrete example of somebody owing you money. And I know that most of the people that write to me about boundaries, it has nothing to do with somebody who owes me money. It has to do with a whole bunch of other things. But people will own the fact that their boundary hasn't been respected. Oh, well, they're going through hard times. Maybe I didn't make it clear that it was a loan. Maybe, blah, blah, blah. You take it on you. If you're taking it on you, you're already bargaining with yourself, like out of the gate. You need to set a boundary. What is the issue? The issue is this person borrowed money. Why did this person borrow money? They needed money. Okay, whose problem was that? Yours or theirs? Theirs. Okay, cool. So they owed somebody else money. They didn't have it. They borrowed money from you. Yes. Whether the terms and conditions of the loan were clear or not, and that's what courts use as to see if a contract is enforceable, and verbal contracts are just as enforceable as written contracts, except in certain areas of law, like real estate transactions. So you can't say, well, it was a verbal contract. So it was a verbal contract is not a defense to you owe me money. It was a verbal contract. You can't prove anything. That doesn't matter. So don't go there. But what were the terms and conditions? Even if you said, you know, even if you didn't have the words at the time that you handed over the money with an expectation of repayment. Was that expectation reasonable? Now, this is another legal thing. This is what courts look at. Did you have a reasonable expectation of repayment? Yes or no? Most of the time, it's yes. Whether the person was waiting for their taxes or waiting for a settlement or waiting for a paycheck or whatever, you could be repaid. So one of the things to look at, and again, if your person has troubles with boundaries, don't take this part of it on. I always get nervous when I tell people this part of it because I know that people who don't have good boundaries will turn themselves inside out to figure out how they didn't make it clear what was expected. So is the boundary reasonable? They borrowed money 6 months ago. They said they paid back when they got their taxes. They pretty much should have had their taxes by now. You haven't seen any money. Now what? Okay, you haven't asked them for it yet. Remember, if you ask somebody something twice and you don't get it, you're bargaining with yourself. So you don't want to go there. So then you start to think, like this person that wrote me this email about fear of conflict, you go to the future. I'm going to say something and they're going to freak out or be upset or whatever. That's not your problem. Who owns the problem that you need to set a boundary around? Most of the time, it's the other person. If it's you because they've dragged you into their drama, their financial mess, their whatever, they still own that problem. The problem started with them needing something. The problem started with something they did or didn't do that they were supposed to do. So if you haven't requested payment or the person to stop doing or do whatever it is that the boundary that you need to set, think about how you can ask for that in reasonable terms. Just say, I wanted to check in with you about the money that I loaned you. Did you get your taxes back? Do you know when you'll be able to pay that? And if the person gives you a song and a dance and everything, say, I really need the money back. I'll give it another month and then I really need to have the money back. And then a month goes by and a month is more than reasonable. You could say 2 weeks. And again, I am trying to give an example that probably isn't going to fit most of the things that people are talking about. But the expectation for the other person is now set. You expect them to pay you back, whether you said at the beginning, whether you said it at the end. Don't listen to any distractions. And I talked about this a little bit on the last podcast. Boundary crashes will give distractions. I thought you cared about me. You know, I was on hard times. I can't believe you. This has nothing to do with that. And don't get sucked into that argument. That is a distraction. It's a smoke screen. Don't go down that rabbit hole. I call it rabbit holes and landmines. Don't go down the rabbit hole. Don't step on the landmines. Avoid those conversations. This isn't about whether or not you care about them. This is about something concrete. And this is what needs to happen. Now, if you're afraid of conflict, you might think, well, where does that come from? Does it come from low self-esteem? I just want everybody to like me. I don't want to be the mean person, blah, blah, blah. I've had clients say, well, dad was an ogre and mom always tried to placate him. So we were never allowed to rock the boat. So I've just never learned to rock the boat, never learned to set a boundary. Okay. You can set boundaries long before you get to the parent inventory, you know, to figure out why you've got that piece of the fear of conflict. You don't have to wait until you're ready to do that. I started setting boundaries very early in my recovery, long before I got into the recovery with my parents. So don't say, oh my God, my fear of conflict comes from dad was an ogre and I haven't done the parent inventory. I got to wait till then. No, you don't. It's like you absolutely don't. You just have to know that conflict is difficult for you for whatever reason. But go to the Power Affirmations book and the Personal Bill of Rights affirmations. I have the right to set boundaries and have them respected. There's a lot going on here. There's a lot of moving parts when it comes to learning how to set boundaries. So go to the Power Affirmations and start shoring up your right to set boundaries. I have the right to set boundaries. I have the right to ask for that money back. I have the right to ask you to stop doing this. I have the right to ask you to start doing that. Whatever it is. And a fear of conflict basically says, if I ask for this, if I set this boundary, there's going to be conflict. Why? Ask yourself why. If you absolutely know there's going to be conflict if you set a boundary, you have to evaluate those relationships in your life. Because if it's not like a family or a boss or a coworker, you might need to end that relationship. You shouldn't have relationships with people where I'm afraid they're going to leave me if I set a boundary. Figure out what is it about fear of conflict that rattles me so. Is it that the other person's going to leave? Okay, so what? If you can't set a reasonable boundary and have it respected, that person doesn't belong in your life. Now, if it's a family member, you still have the right to set boundaries, but you probably know that when you set the boundary, there's going to be conflict. So that's where it needs to end. You need to think about, one, am I bargaining with myself? Two, have I figured out that whatever boundary needs to be set is reasonable? And don't talk yourself out of it at this point. Don't take on, well, maybe I didn't really say it right, or blah, blah, blah. Forget it. It's a new day. When you're thinking about fear of conflict, you're thinking about conflict. not. That's because you don't want to go down those rabbit holes. So what you have to do is you have to think about the boundary you want to set, and you have to commit to not going down those rabbit holes, meaning you just repeat your boundary. We're not talking about that. We're not talking about whether or not I care about you. We're not talking about this or that. You don't want to go there with people. Just don't go there with people. So when you think about setting boundaries, think about where it all falls apart. And if it all falls apart because you're going to set a boundary and there's going to be conflict, you need to figure out how to set the boundary and leave the conflict. And how you leave the conflict is, we're not talking about that now. We're talking about this. Those other things are distractions. And boundary crashes will crash your boundaries. They'll say things like, oh, I thought you cared about me. You know I'm having a hard time. But it doesn't matter. Those are you problems. My problem is that you owe me money. And I'm not saying you say that, but you have to go in there with that attitude. Whatever they say, oh, you know, I'm having a hard time, blah, blah, blah. It's like, that's a you issue, not a me issue. And I talk about this in the workbook, and I talk about this in the book. Who owns this? Who owns this? You don't own this. Don't go down the rabbit holes. Don't step on the landmines. And evaluate your relationships with people. Sometimes you just have to end the relationship and go, I'm into the relationship. I'm sending you like a 90-day notice, demand for payment, and that's it. But chances are the people that I see usually don't do that. So then you go to setting the boundary. And in the workbook, I have, I'll say this, they'll say that. I'll say this, they'll say that. And like I talk about in Getting Past Your Breakup, in the situation with the two women in the movies, you have to say what the consequences are. It says, you know, I am your friend. I love you. I care about you, but I don't want to miss the movie anymore. And the other person says, oh, the beginning of that movie is more important than me. Okay, that's a preposterous argument. Don't be ridiculous. Just don't be ridiculous. Don't fall into that. Don't fall into that at all. So many people that I work with will fall into that, and then they'll say to me, oh, I'm such a nice person. I'm a good person. I have a good heart. No, you're an idiot. It's like, no, set the boundary and let them worry about whether or not you care about them. Don't go down the rabbit hole and just say, you know, like the woman in the book said, I'm waiting 10 minutes. And if you're not here, I'm leaving. And that's it. That's what she needed to do. So the next time they went to the movies together or didn't go to the movies together, whatever it was, because she had to think about a solution to that. Is it that we're not going to be friends anymore? Is it that we're going to be friends, but we're not going to go to the movies together? Or is it that we're going to be friends and go to the movies and you're going to be on time? Because those are the only three choices. What's not on the table as a choice, as I'm going to continue to wait for you and you're going to bluster and bellyache and say all kinds of crazy things to me that have nothing to do with be on time for the movies. Like, this isn't about the whole world. This is about be on time for the movies. Okay, it's very simple. So make sure you simplify your boundary in your head before you even go to set it. You have to set it in your head. And you might feel like a bad friend. You might feel like a bad whatever. But that's the aftermath of setting the boundary. That's the, I feel so mean. Okay, well, the thing that I say, and I said it on the last podcast, I've said it on many other podcasts, I'll say it again, Melody Beatty says you cannot set a boundary and take care of somebody else's feeling at the same time. You can't, you just can't. So before you go in there, you have to take that end piece and move it to the beginning. You don't want to say in affirmations, I'm not mean. You want to say something like, a healthy person has good boundaries. To get away from that, I feel mean. You can feel mean. You know, sometimes people feel exhausted after they've set a boundary, but whose fault is that? You own some of that. The boundary crasher owns some of that, but this is the way out of that. The more you do it, the better you feel. The more you do it, the less you're going to feel mean. And don't think about, well, you know, I always set them up to believe that I'm the person that takes care of everything. Okay, but those days are over. It's like my therapist said to me, you need to quit your job of running the universe because you're overworked and underpaid. And this is exactly what she was talking about. She was talking about me not setting boundaries. So you need to quit your job of running the universe because you're overworked and underpaid. So if that thought comes into your head, well, I'm always the person that takes care of things, blah, blah, blah. It's like, fine, but you're not doing it this time. You're not doing it anymore. People have taken advantage of you and it needs to stop. And it needs to stop now. And you need to know you can do this because you're never going to feel good about yourself until you know you can do this. So what's more important, feeling mean or feeling good about the fact that you can set boundaries? Somebody owes you $500 and you ask them for it back, you finally get it back, but you feel so mean that you ask them for it. It's like, okay, well, you feel mean and now you have $500. It's like, but before you were not feeling mean and didn't have $500. I'd rather the first one. So you have to think about beginning, middle, end with boundaries. And the beginning is know what a reasonable boundary is. Know what a reasonable request is. And if you have questions about that, write me and give me an example and I'll tell you whether it's reasonable or not. But most of the time, it's not about letting people slide. That's not reasonable because that's unreasonable where you are concerned. So when you're thinking about reasonableness, think about you. How reasonable is it for somebody to borrow money from you and not pay it back and not mention it again? It's not reasonable. It's not reasonable. So going in and saying, I really need this money back is not unreasonable. It's just not. And you have to get your brain around that. And you also have to get your brain around, sometimes it just doesn't feel good when you've set a boundary, but it will feel good. The more you do this, the easier it gets. So think about the beginning, think about the middle, and the middle is like, I'll say this, they'll say that, but, and how are you going to combat that? Make sure you're doing your personal Bill of Rights affirmations, and make sure you're looking at the whole picture. If you're a person with low self-esteem, if you've been codependent, if you've been just the person that does everything for everybody, it's time for that to stop. You need to take care of you. And when I wasn't being pulled to and fro by everybody in my life, I almost didn't know what to do. It just felt so weird and strange. So prepare yourself for that too. And prepare yourself for the thing that I talk about in the books, like boundary crashes will up the ante. You know, sometimes they'll make snide remarks. Oh, here comes Miss, I need to pay you back. I was like, really? Really? Or just smile and say, yep, that's me. You have to learn to change the dance steps. That's the only way you learn how to set boundaries, is by changing the dance step. And if you're afraid of conflict, you have to figure out why. And you have to figure out, why do I think if I set a boundary, there's going to be conflict? And if there is conflict, where does that fall apart? And I've talked to a few clients this past week about laundry lists. You know, one of the things that my ex used to do is he used to just keep these laundry lists in his head of all these things that I'd done since the beginning of time. And we would get into an argument about something and he would be bringing up all these things and, you know, my head would be spinning. I didn't know. I was like, what? They were all rabbit holes. I couldn't remember that. And then like hours later, I'd be thinking, I'd be like, oh, well, the reason that happened was because of this, you know, something he did. But when somebody has you on the ropes, they know it. If somebody sees you as a pushover, a soft touch, you're going to know it. And you have to announce that that's not going to happen anymore. And I just say this to my ex after we were separated. I'm not arguing about those things. We're arguing about this one thing. I'm not going there. Boundary crashes will find all kinds of things for you to argue about. All kinds of things for you to argue about. But keep it short and simple and keep reminding yourself what this is about. And that you have the right to set boundaries. And the other thing is, listen to your self-talk when you're trying to shore up the fact that a boundary needs to be set and you need to set it. What are the arguments that are going to punch holes in that boundary? The person says, you know, I've been on hard times. And then you feel like a complete a-hole because they've been on hard times. Those hard times are not your problem. And that sounds mean, but you have to take that tact about it. It's not my problem. And I'm not saying say it to the face of somebody that you want to remain in a decent relationship with. But when boundary crashes say these things, it's always to pull you into why you're wrong for setting this boundary. And again, avoid that. Just keep thinking it's about this one thing. And there doesn't need to be conflict for boundaries. I just need to set my boundaries. boundary, set what my expectation is. I expect to be paid within 90 days, which is a long time, or 30 days, or whatever it is you want to do. And if that doesn't happen, I'm going to have to take you to court. And that might be something that you want to save for the second time you ask for it, but you definitely don't want there to be a third time. So if the second time comes and you say to the person, look, I really need this money. I've given you this amount of time. If I don't have the money in 30 days, I'm going to have to take you to court, and they will lose their shit. But that's what you have to do, because when you get to the second time, you have to set a boundary and enforce it, or bargain with yourself. Stop bargaining with yourself. And if you've always been the soft touch, if you've always been the person that people go to, you got to take that out of your rotation of self-image. If you're always helping other people to be liked, to be loved, to be cared about, that's not how it needs to go. You need to care about you and raise your self-esteem. And again, you don't have to wait until your self-esteem is high to set a boundary. I started setting them when I had like a thimble full of self-esteem. But I'll tell you, the act of me setting boundaries and following through on them helped my self-esteem immensely. There's a huge payoff for setting boundaries. And yeah, you might feel mean and you might feel rattled. You might feel this, you might feel that. Fine. You know, feelings aren't right or wrong. They just are. Let them happen. But that doesn't mean you don't set boundaries. You still keep setting those boundaries and let someone else worry about whatever. And just know that even if you feel sad or mean, or you weren't quite sure what to do, just know that you sticking to your boundaries will raise your self-esteem. It's hard work, but it's exactly what needs to happen. You cannot be a healthy person without good boundaries. And on one of the previous podcasts, I talked about how people have asked me, you know, how I put the program together. And I went through all kinds of materials that worked for me. And even before I was a therapist, officially a therapist, I worked with other people and I helped them by passing on the things that helped me. Some of them I passed on and didn't do much for anybody but me. But other times I found that what was really helpful to me was really helpful to all the people I worked with. So for over 25 years, I've been saying the same thing about boundaries. It was one of the first things I learned. And if you struggle with boundaries, you really should be. Most of the GPYB stuff is based on stuff my therapist said to me, both therapists, my first therapist, my second therapist, and Melody Beatty. Read Codependent No More. Read Beyond Codependency. Those two books solidified for me the importance of boundaries. And when you read those books and you'll read her sections on boundaries, you'll see GPYB everywhere, because I take so much from that, because she spoke a language that I understood. And I went, whoa, you cannot take care of someone else's feelings and set a boundary at the same time. And I was like, whoa, that's a big one. That's a big one. The 3-time rule. After 3 times, you know, on the 3rd time, you're bargaining with yourself. Don't get there. Don't go there. Don't back down. Because if you back down, then you're going to feel horrible about yourself. And then the low self-esteem continues. There is so much good stuff in setting boundaries. So boundaries is one of the first things I talk to people about when they started working with me, even as a new therapist and even in, you know, running women's groups and things like that. And people always say, I'm a nice person, I'm a giving person. No, you're a fool. You're a fool. If you're a nice person, you're a giving person, I expect you to be down at the soup kitchen this weekend handing out soup to the homeless. If you're so giving, I expect to see you down the animal shelter cleaning out the cages. I expect to see you at the domestic violence shelter helping people there do whatever they do. That's what a nice person does, not bail out everybody in my life. If you're bailing out everybody in your life, you're avoiding things with people in your life. That doesn't make you a nice person, a good person. Blah, blah, blah. It makes you an idiot, and you don't want to be an idiot. So stop being an idiot. So when I went back and I looked at all the things that helped me, and the way I put all this stuff together, was unique to GPYB. It was just something that just sort of evolved over the years of me working with people. There was always affirmations. There was always act as if. There was always journaling. There was always grief. There was always emotions. And there was always boundaries. Always boundaries. Because it starts there. It starts with taking care of you. And remember, you have to let the bad stuff out and the good stuff in. And boundaries is one of those places where you can kind of figure out where you are. And GPYB, you know, the part that's really unique to it is the part that I kind of made up. I don't like to say made up, like it's all fictionalized, but observation, preparation, cultivation. Because when I went back and I realized, like, when I slowed everything down, I looked at things, I kind of stopped responding, because when you grew up in a dysfunctional home, you're just in always reaction mode, always in reaction mode, hypervigilant to the max, always looking for trouble, always trying to ward off trouble, always trying to avoid trouble. And if somebody says something like you didn't do X, Y, or Z, you're ready with an answer. And I had to learn to sit back and watch people and see people and listen to people and figure out where they were in my life and if I wanted them in my life, and then to step back and see what I was doing. Okay, normally, how would I respond in this situation? And my therapist said, know what you think, know what you feel, and act on what you think and feel. And if you don't know that, or they're not in concert with each other, do nothing. And I learned to do a lot of nothing. And people would say to me, what'd you do all day? And I'd be like, I did nothing. Like, that's what I did. A whole lot of nothing. You know, no contact. It was a whole slew of not doing things. I didn't contact my ex. I didn't try to get into a relationship with somebody new. I didn't do this. I didn't do that. It was a whole lot of not doing. That's what I did a whole bunch of, is not doing. And then preparation is thinking about, where do things fall apart? When you're talking about boundaries, it's like, where does it fall apart? Does it fall apart at the beginning, the middle, the end, maybe all three? Where is it? Where do we need work? And then cultivation, keep doing it, keep doing it, keep doing it. And the first few times are hard, but they're absolutely essential, absolutely essential. And I always say to people, the reason that I say that you can't cherry pick GPYB, and you can't say, well, I'll do this part of the program without that part of the program, is they all work together. And when you're going through your relationship inventory, your life inventory, your parent inventory, you need people in your corner. You need people who they're going to support you. You don't need people that are just going to drag you down. And if there are people who are taking advantage of you because you don't have boundaries, those people are dragging you down. And that's going to affect all your other work and all the other things that you do. So you have to make sure that you're not allowing those things to happen. And cultivation is doing the healthy things over and over and over and over again. And don't slack off. If you're doing all this work to figure out your boundaries and to put your boundaries in place, and you've got some personal Bill of Rights affirmations in your daily affirmation list, don't start discarding them after you've set a couple of boundaries. Go, hey, this is cake, I can do it. No, you have to keep doing it. You have to keep telling yourself that you have the right to set boundaries, because you do. And that's a very, very important part. So I want you to take away from this, in order to set boundaries, if you have a fear of conflict, you need to figure out why you think that there's going to be conflict just because you set a boundary. A good, healthy, reasonable boundary should not lead to conflict. If it does, something's wrong. It means that you're talking about boundary crashers. They're not going to understand. Okay, that doesn't matter. There doesn't have to be conflict after you set a boundary. And decide how you're going to avoid that from happening. I'm going to stay on the subject. I'm only going to talk about this. I'm not going to talk about that. If they try to drag me down these rabbit holes and throw up these distractions and smoke screens, I'm out of there. I'm not dealing with it. Think about the 3-time rule. Think about, on the third time, you're bargaining with yourself. 3-time rule is time to enforce a consequence, or it's time to back down and go, okay, fuck it, I can't do this. And you don't want that. And if it's in the words, go to the workbook, do the conversations, figure it out. And when it comes to, oh, you don't care about me anymore, that's a rabbit hole. Don't get sucked down there. And don't listen. Just say, look, like the woman in the book did with the with the movie. I still want to be friends with you, but maybe we need to be friends who don't go to the movies together. Her friend knew she was serious when she was serious, but this was a whole other person. And then people have said to me, well, they don't know that I mean it because I've never meant it before. Okay, that doesn't matter. Whatever's going on in their mind, in their life, in their head, in their whatever, it doesn't matter. That's their deal. You cannot take care of their feelings. You can't take care of their perception that you're a pushover and now there's a new day and they never got the memo. So you want to take it on as your fault. Well, I didn't really tell them like I'm a healthy person now setting boundaries. You don't need to. We're not sending out boundary newsletters. It's like, just do it. Don't let those little thoughts derail you. And when I've talked about resistance in other podcasts, this is where resistance comes in a lot, where people are making excuses for people they shouldn't make excuses for. And remember, whose problem is this? When you're preparing to set a boundary, keep thinking, like, whose problem is this? The initial problem was the other person's. Me setting a boundary is mine. I need to do something about it. How do I need to do that? I need to look at the ways I think it's going to fall apart, and I need to have that all figured out before I get there. I need to do my affirmations. I need to convince myself that a healthy person has good boundaries, blah, blah, blah. If I want to be a good, healthy person, I need to have good, healthy boundaries. And then dealing with the aftermath. How do I feel in the aftermath of setting a boundary? I feel horrible. I feel like I let people down. But. Okay, fine. But you have to own that, deal with it, and figure out how you're going to work that into your program. Codependency is something that we get into because we want other people to like us and not be mad at us and not go away. But it kills us. And we need to stop letting it kill us. And I'll tell you, I always tell people, if you get into a relationship with somebody and they have a toxic relationship with their ex where they're always taking care of their ex, because there are those relationships, you need to look at that as a bird's eye view into you. Because if they're not setting boundaries with their ex, chances are some of that dysfunction is coming into your relationship with them. Their dysfunction is your dysfunction, is both of your dysfunctions, but you need to acknowledge it. Are you getting into relationships with people that are caretaking their ex? Because if you are, there's something wrong with that, and that needs to stop and that needs to change. So like I said, again, there's a lot of moving parts to this, but I absolutely believe you can do it. I look forward to your email on the subject. Please keep me posted. Let me know what you think. If you were the person who asked me about fear of conflict, let me know what you think. And we'll talk about it some more, I'm sure. Take care, everybody. This is Nellie, host of the Millennial Talk Podcast. Talk to you all soon. Take care, everybody. Bye-bye.